Good evening, everybody, and welcome to our third Environment and Climate Change Select Committee. I'd like to welcome you all. Before we start, let us have a minute of silence for Ron Odunaya, who was our Director of Community Services, who sadly passed recently. Can you all please stand up?
Liverpool City Centre connectivity scheme
and its ongoing development in terms of its impact on the environment. I'm aware that this update on this scheme is going to regeneration, but we also need to be aware of this in terms of impact on the environment. Festival gardens also will be appearing at this committee in near future. So that's what we have at the moment. So if you please have any ideas for any other business, would you please email me? Okay? The agree? Yes? Yes.
Yeah, thanks for that, Lena. I do agree. It's disappointing not to have presentations or any sort of submissions to this. Also, thanks to the cabinet member for obviously, on such an issue as climate change, to have such a thin agenda is very disappointing. So, I do hope we've got, you know, for our work in the future, and we'll be suggesting something to you.
Thank you, Councillor. Now, we are aware that we do have four different task groups, and in a way, that also becomes the main issue for us, is to kind of have reports of these task groups and how well they are performing and where they are at the moment. So, let us get going. Item number one, declaration of interests. Can I ask if members have any interest to declare relating to the items of business on this evening's agenda? No? Thank you. Minutes of the last meeting, 16th of December 2019. Can I refer to the pages 1 to 24? Of the agenda pack, which I believe you would have read by now. Do we have any comments? Okay, can these minutes be approved, please? Agreed, thank you. And we are moving now to our main item of the agenda, which is a cabinet member update. So, can I now invite, please, Councillor Robertson-Collins to introduce her cabinet member update that you should all have, copies of which are in front of the members and are available to the members of the public. Please, Laura.
Many thanks, Chair. Yeah, can I just absolutely check that everyone has got sight of this report? It is a matter of public record, my cabinet member reports to this committee. And the previous ones are obviously available through the council system because they go on as part of the minutes of the committee. So it is important that everybody has sight of that. As I say, we've got other members, I'm members of the public in the room, you know, they haven't introduced themselves, but it's good that they're here and they're interested in the issues, but it's important they have sight of the papers that we're looking at here.
It's okay.
With regard to your comments, just then, Chair, I completely agree with you. I think when I produced my first report in November, I did suggest some other items that would potentially be of interest to the committee. Obviously, it's not up to me what the committee did. It is, of course, up to the committee. But although I would always be here as the Environment Cabinet member, the committee is obviously can call all the members. I mean, environment does absolutely stretch across all areas of service delivery and policy with the council. Doing that should be underlying and overriding everything that we do. So just to make sure that members are aware, they don't have to be restricted to only listening to me. Obviously, it's great that you do listen to me, but you can call for officers, you can call for other people, you can call external partners. And if you refer back to my November committee, I did make some suggestions, and I think you referred to some of them there. So going back to the 16th of December, I think I started my report that day by saying it had been a particularly good week for either progressive politics or for environmentalism. We've managed to actually go downhill since then, which is pretty good going, I'd say. Having passed into transition from the European Union, which is, I'm not happy about it. I'm good to know that I still got my t-shirt. Since we're in the EU. There's been things in the EU just this week. The Tory, not a friend of mine, but she was meant to be organising a COP conference in Glasgow at the autumn, and she's managed to have been sacked by the Tories. I'm not quite sure what's going on there, but apparently the Tories haven't had a cabinet meeting of their climate change cabinet, or whatever it is they're meant to be doing, as they take the lead on this for this year. I think that is of really serious concern to all of us. obviously we've lost our executive director extremely tragically in the last couple of weeks, and that does create a big hole because Ronald and I was the executive director who was responsible within the council executive director level for leading on that climate change work. So we have to be realistic about the resources that we've lost there, as well as obviously it being a massive tragedy to his family and everything. But the officers are going to give updates on those areas. I've referred back to my three particular focus areas of work. That doesn't mean that we're not doing other things. It doesn't mean that I'm not doing things. It's just some areas where there's been a lot going on in the last 6 weeks or so that I've drawn attention to here. So with air quality and transport, which is one of my main priorities, a lot happening. There's been a lot of reports coming out. We had the launch of the prejudicial foundation report in Liverpool just last week. Our own King Martin was on the panel at that event, so we're a lot of health experts very much supporting what we're suggesting doing in Liverpool and providing that really, really hard evidence behind what we're doing there. Centre for Cities similarly have had the national report come out this week. I've put some details into my report about what the British Fund Foundation has said. I'm sure people in this room won't be surprised by it. I mean, the very frightening statistics around mortality and illness that are caused by air pollution, and they are very closely linked to deprivation. So all those centre facilities I think we refer to, problems in the southeast caused by air pollution being blown over from Europe. I'm sure it's not a comment about Brexit. Air pollution problems in the southeast, there is the underlying issue that air pollution is particularly closely connected with deprivation generally, and therefore it's a real social justice issue, and that's why we've got real problems in the northern cities and the core cities, and why we are moving to take action. I'm not sure if Lily's got some more specific things she can update us on with regard to the debate with Debra about exactly what we're doing here. Hopefully she can fill us in on some of that detail, but that work is carrying on. And I think there's a real issue in the city that people don't fully appreciate. There's a bit of the echo that we will be having clean air zones fairly soon, depending on the consultation obviously, but that work is progressing as it is in other cities. And that will have a real impact on the city. That will make a real difference about that whole concept of driving wherever you want to drive, whenever you want to drive. Hopefully, let's say, it will kickstart that debate, as well as having practical implications in terms of making sure we meet compliance, making sure we improve our air quality, but also really quickly raising that as an issue. So more specifically with air quality and transport issues, I refer there to the City Centre Connectivity Scheme, which you referred to yourself as Chair. A report went on that. There's still some things being debated around that. There are literally some things being debated at the moment. I've just left one meeting where they're debating them. So there's a lot of issues there about prioritising public transport. Great news about Hanover Street, but we've got the enforcement there. Great news about some of the cycling and the greening issues. And making sure that we get that right now, because obviously this is kind of a once in a generation type change, and we have to absolutely make sure we get that right. I've just put a little tiny paragraph on cycling in the report because very kindly our cycling czar is here. He will obviously speak on that in more detail. Obviously, we're working closely together on that with some external partners, but also in the city. Simon's not only the cycling czar for the city council, but for the city region as well, which gives us a real opportunity. We heard from Ian Robinson at our last meeting. He spoke in depth about the city region are trying to do in terms of active travel to public transport. There's some exciting stuff going on, and I know that Simon's got some quite aspirational maps there in terms of cycling infrastructure and so on. What I was very keen to do was make sure that the councillors had seen those at this early stage, because I'm very aware as a long-term backlash councillor that sometimes things appear and you haven't necessarily been fully consulted, so I've asked Simon to call, make sure we run that past councillors, make sure councillors are happy with what you intend to do with those, so we don't want some problems later on. But also so that councils can take those issues up and champion them, because obviously if we are changing road priorities, infrastructure and everything like that, it's really important that councils understand why, so they can be championing that need for active travel in their ward. So massive thanks to Simon for being here, and I'll bring him in when I've gone through the rest of this brief sick paper board. Walking to school campaign is something we are already pushing on, and have referred to it a couple of times in these meetings. It is very much a wicked issue that's demonstrated by the fact we have four cabinet members, four different portfolios needed to be involved with that, with education, highways, obviously environment, and also inclusion and accessibility. So the discussion is the last meeting, somebody did ask me about enforcement. I did agree with them that we should have stronger enforcement. I think my point is that they should actually be dead off apart from the paper now, so I suppose it's slightly tongue in cheek, but I'm not sure if they well, I can say whatever I want this time, if I can. I think I might have made a joke about hanging on the floor, but that was lovely.
You didn't say that.
But obviously, we do need to make sure that enforcement's there, but more importantly, we need that message about behaviour change. So there's the questionnaires going out to schools and the letter going out to schools. So page 3 and 4 of your report is literally so members have those questions and those that letter that's gone out from highways through the schools team in Toxic Finance. So it should have reached all schools. And it's really important that councils are really proactive in making sure their schools come back to us on that. That does not in any way preclude local councils working with local schools and supporting them in any other, you know, things that they want. If they're asking for me, I'm able to fund to help them get by things or signage or whatever. Please don't say no, wait for the citywide campaign. I mean, please carry on doing all that kind of stuff anyway. But there will be, there's a real push to actually get some pilot road closures going on, and we have to have schools that are really willing to support that. There is no sort of magic council resource where we can come in and just put that in place. So what we need to do is work with schools who are willing to do that, who are willing to contribute a resource to that, and then we can support them doing it. Yes, school governors or the school staff will be able to help with that, then we can have a training and the legal side of that. So it has to be a partnership. So yes, the questionnaires were asked to be returned by the 7th, which is probably the end of this week. We gave them quite a short time to be able to try and focus that. So any schools that you're in contact with, whether it's parents, governors, obviously both the councils, in the audience as well, Councillor Hanson, just to make sure that everybody really pushes on that, and of course members of the public as well, if you have connections with schools, to make sure they get that information back with us, because obviously we can then progress with the pilots with the most information possible across the city from all the schools. So of the 6-page report, 2 pages are the bad information. I'll make sure that goes out electronically to elected members as well, so you've all got that, to all elected members, not just on this committee, and we really do need you to push on that. Really important that we get this message out citywide. It's not just the city centre thing, it'll be cleaner zone, it'll be city centre focus, but that we start getting behaviour change messages out across the whole city, and we need everyone to be championing that. On to page 5, I did want to bring a bit of extra information around trees, because I said there was a lot going on with trees, a lot of extra trees being planted, which is really, really good news. This, what I put in the report is in addition to what we would be doing normally as a council. So I specifically referred here to the green app, which will provide 145 trees or thereabouts. The urban tree challenge one, which is just about to be signed off, that's about street trees, we're nearly 700 on those, and then 12,000 baby trees in the parks through the green partnership with Mersey Forest as part of the Northern Forest project. Some councils will already be contacted directly by park staff because the planting is in your ward, so some people may already have quite a lot of information on it. But thousands and thousands of trees will be community planting involved, councils will be informed. That's in Dovecot Park, Everton Park, Garston Park, Oswestall, Princess Park, Stanley Park, Sefton Park, Stapleton Avenue, which can speak, and also the mystery in Wake Tree. So I think that's some really good, exciting news about green in the city, and hopefully everyone can get involved with what's going on in the city. The most important part of this entire report, Chair, is don't worry about Brexit, austerity, or any other political minions like that, is the alternate vote. Okay, we have to win this vote, folks. And the alternate was UK Tree of the Year last year, and here is the trophy. I have a certificate of authentication, from the Woodland Trust. So this is the bespoke trophy. It's Liverpool's forever, or it's the Oaks forever. And helping you look after it. So we won the UK Tree of the Year last year because everybody got behind the tree and voted for it to be the only northern tree in the England shortlist. It's now voting is open for the European Tree of the Year. You can vote while you're sitting in this room. I won't be offended if you get your phones out now. And you do need to confirm on the it sends you an email, so just doing it on vote, you can put it on your social media and your leaflets and so on. It's got to the end of the month to vote. And I really appreciate anything you can do to help on that. With regard to waste reduction, which is kind of the area of my personal focuses in this work, is the latest story on that, I think, is that we have not put charges on for green waste, and I'm really, really pleased that my views were listened to within the Wigan Cabinet and the Mayor listened to that. It's very tempting after the 10th year of massive global austerity from the Tory government and more cuts and a really depressing budget situation, still over their funding and all the rest of it's gone up. I understand my local authorities are tempted by the easy money that looks like charging for green waste. But I have made the point, and the Mayor absolutely supported the point, that we should not be charging people for collecting recyclable waste. That's the wrong message, and that people who are recycling should be supported to do the right thing. So I'm really, really pleased with that budget decision. I think it's really helpful in terms of the sustainability agenda, even though it's not as helpful in terms of the budget for the Council. And I want to extend my thanks to the Mayor for listening to that argument. We did all agree a fireworks motion, which was the RSPCA motion, so that has a pulling practice committee with regard to animal welfare. I wasn't physically threatened on this occasion, I'm not going to be banned for the gun show. We've all agreed to take this action on fireworks, and I do actually need to make sure that I'll make sure we chase up the actions on there, because there's some actions agreed across party there. But also for everyone to be aware that we've asked for these things to be done, to be promoting some of that stuff in the wards. I'm sure you'll get lots of issues raised around fireworks, both the environmental problem with the mess, but also the disturbance to pets as well as to wildlife. I did attend the MPA Labour Group's Climate Emergency Conference last Friday. I got the train. That was really useful because obviously, you know, it is one of the authorities that I've been on this agenda across the city, and it is very reassuring to have that support and advice from my colleagues around the city. And thanks to the Echo for their publicity, also for they've got their #DoOneThing campaign, which is part of a national campaign around promoting sustainability for 2020. And I think it can be easy for those who are still quite into this agenda to kind of get quite technical about some of it, and be talking about carbon reduction plans and particulate matter and, you know, the sort of amount of NOx in the air and all the rest of it. I think we have to remember that we need some really simple messages and some really kind of vaguely enjoyable things that's not just always seen as a negative thing to the general public. So I couldn't think of one thing. I asked them to put three things in for me, but they actually came up with a list of 50 that were in the Echo, asking people to do, you know, quite simple things that people can do locally in terms of obviously walking to school, get compost bins, plant some wildflowers, doing this, fix those kind of things. But also councillors to throw back to elected members again and ask them to kind of promote those simpler elements of sustainability, as well as selling some of the hard-edged stuff around clean air zones and so on. So that's my report, Chair. And I'm going to ask if, as part of my report, Simon can point, if that's okay.
Okay, thanks. Unless I'm breaking the council rule, I'll have to put ceremonies and get into the middle.
Yes, thank you.
Two main recommendations that came out of that review are two blue lines on it, and they are the LC Whip suggested corridors for the next round of Transform the City's funding. And when you start putting them on the map, these lines, you start to see a network developing. The red lines are largely, my first port of call when I was trying to find segregated cycle lanes is I went to the old tramline lines, because where there were tramlines, largely there was space. So down the avenues and down the wide kind of boulevards around the city, you can find space. When you look at it, it kind of doesn't look like a network. But then if I pick out one line, we have this blue line here, which is part of the connectivity scheme. We then have plenty of space going up this road here. Then there's a large issues road here, which is not people at all, no residents and not much industry at all. That's Bowler Street, and then you join this line here, and suddenly you have a straight line which can be connected, and can be connected, to my mind, in an economic way. So the next piece of work I'll be doing with this map now is to put them all together and layer them so that everyone can see them and look at where did we start. So let's have a look where we start. We're already fairly advanced in the consultation stage with some engineers, Matt Mott, because the mayor is very keen, and so is the city region mayor, are very keen on creating the Liverpool Loop, which is to get rid of the disconnect between the Leeds Liverpool Canal and Liverpool Strand, and at the other end from Speke Boulevard, which has a good cycle lane, it needs upgrading, but it has a good cycle lane going back to College Avenue. And then there's a disconnect of the problem. So we've been out with the engineers that scrubbed both of those, and they're now giving us the different alternatives on a kind of a rag roster scheme. They will be reporting back within the next week to us, and then that can get costed up. The mayor's very keen for that to be the first part, because as well as being great for tourism and for leisure, they have a 30-mile absolutely segregated route. Is also part the start of a network, because I was very keen, if we're going to spend money, not just to create something which is nice for the day out, but it's also a useful mode of transport. So if I start in Speed and cut through Garston, that's the trickiest bit, past the docks and crescent to the Grassendale Park, down Epworth Road, back to the prom, not only do you start to create that loop, which a family might like to use, but you've also connected Speed directly to the city centre along the promenade, completely off-road. So that's kind of the methodology I'm going with. What I would like to point out at this point, I've been absolutely insistent in this piece of work, that I would say to all cabinet members here, and anyone who wants to hear, that painted lines simply are not good enough. They will not do, they will look good, and there's a body of evidence, a huge body of evidence, that suggests they actually make closer to people on white line cycle lanes than if there's no cycle lane at all. So if we are going to go forward, do it properly. We call it the London Standard, it's what Manchester have started using. That is the standard we should all be looking at, I believe. Otherwise, please stop wasting money on painting the roads, because it does nothing at all. And so this could be a network which we will cost. The costing, the standard, is around £1 million a mile for cycle lane. Obviously, some areas, some parts are cheaper, but then you have the major junction. And I would also ask Liverpool to completely change the way we think about cycle lanes, because at the moment, I've always joked that what you should have on cycle lanes in Liverpool is every time you get to a major junction, instead of having a bike there, you should just have crossed fingers. Just say, good luck, see you on the other side. And that has to change. And that has to change very quickly, or we will never, ever, ever encourage more people to cycle. Detractors say not many people cycle in Liverpool, which I was taught in 1836, no one took the train, because there were no train lines. Now there are 1.74 billion train journeys every year. If you provide it, I believe people will use it. That's evidence throughout the country and throughout Europe and the rest of the world. So that's the kind of piece of work I'm working on. We're going to break it down by, I'd like to come and present back at the end of March, because what we're going to do is break it down into not only what is deliverable and how much it costs, but the
process. Thank you very much. Thank you to Laura and thank you to Simon. Excellent. Thank you so much for updating us on this. So, in terms of the process, what we have now is, first of all, the members of this committee are going to be given an opportunity to ask any questions of Laura and of Simon as well. I have some questions as well, and then after that we shall open to public. Okay, so we have from Councillor Brown.
Chair, thank you for that, Simon. I agree with you, we need more segregated cyber for the city. Million dollar question that, you know, try your best to answer is how we win the argument at the end of the day. You know, this is great, but you and I both know, place I represent, that, you know, it's going to get opposition from people who literally, I can't move my car out onto my drive. And that's what we're trying to stop here, we're trying to get people away from cars. Cycle and walking and things like that. How are we ultimately going to win the argument? What it can't be is, you know, a cycle lane introduced, you know, there's a TRO, you know, a statutory consultation for 2 weeks, and that's it, and it gets proposed and it's defeated at that. It's going to involve a long pre-process of people owning it. So my question really just kind of give you a statement how we kind of own, you know, how we kind of own and win the argument.
Yeah, I completely agree. I think the first thing we have to do very quickly decide between council members and between officers where the best places for the routes are. And once you've done that, then take that to public consultation, put your own message. Because what we're doing on a national level, we're working with the other cycling and walking commissioners, we form a forum, and what we're looking at is best practice that already exists within the country. It's no good, I don't think, showing people statistics and pie charts and that kind of stuff. And I think many people will be aware of an excellent example I'm going to see on Thursday, which is Waltham Forest in north east London. 5 years ago, the traders in Waltham Forest carried a coffin down the middle of the road because the council's idea of taking out traffic from the high street and only putting a bus and cycle lane through it, they said it was the last nail in the coffin of their businesses. 5 years later, if you talk to any of those traders, they would say they were completely wrong. Is thriving and is an absolute example, a positive example. So what I would say is where these routes are going to go past commercial premises, then own the message. Walk in to a meeting with this example and tell them, yeah, no one likes change, but we do have to change and it won't be what you think it's going to be. So to do that there, and to have schools, I noted Laura mentioned schools, well, we're working with West Derby. Sustrans have just identified a shortlist of 3 primary schools that they're going to be wanting to do their own temporary road closures of their own band and to monitor that from baseline. So to monitor it now for pollution, to monitor it now for how the attitude of the parents at drop-off is, and then monitor it as it goes through, and monitor it in a year's time when it's been closed, when the closure has been in place for a year, and see how the attitude changes. I know that in other parts of the country where schools will be bold enough to put in their own to clean their zone, their own no-go zone, there was a lot of opposition to it to start with, and a few years down the line, all I've heard to say is improved. And so to own that message in that way. I believe, well, you're right, there will be a book, but I'm quite happy to front that.
Thank you. Thank you, Councillor.
Thank you, Chair. Specifically on Simon's presentation, obviously this is partly, as you say, coming off from the Green Spaces Review and the and that was what, 5 years, about 4 years or 5 years ago effectively when this was effectively put together. Not much as we pointed out has happened since in regards to as far as segregated cycling is concerned in the city. So you know we do need to move ahead very quickly on this sort of business. He just put us down Waltham Forest, for example. There was objections to the potential pedestrianisation and cycling of the boats So you pointed out a major loop in the city that you're progressing. Obviously, hopefully that's all going scrutiny through regeneration, so I think it would be really good if it's brought here as well as specifics in detail so we can take a look at that. But I'd like to see a lot more of this progressing very quickly than just that as well. We do need to move ahead with all the funding opportunities that we've got. Most other cities, but a lot of other cities in the country are moving ahead a lot quicker. So we need to copy that at least. If not, taking away car space to provide cycle and walking space, because that's the sort of thing that's happening in Waltham Forest, that's the sort of thing that needs to happen there. We've got a few questions as well for Laura. Just on this school streets pilot question, the pilot idea that it's not clear, well, it wasn't clear. He said the funding for TROs is coming from that. Is that the council providing that, or are the schools expecting to provide resources? So that's one question. And you mentioned about the city centre connectivity scheme. Obviously, there's a couple of examples of segregated cycling, but there's other parts of the scheme that have got that in. And you know, we do, like I just said, we do need to move ahead as quickly as possible on all schemes in the future, because you know, we've had a lot of roads, the A59, the A57, etc. that have not had cycle facilities put in the past few years, and they need to be moved ahead on as quickly as possible.
Thank you. Laura, do you want to come back?
Just specific on the schools, what you want, because we have to have evidence that the schools really bought into wanting something in our streets. So they've got staff and support and so on for it. I'm not asking for actual cash from the school. We won't have to find that on my own council. But in terms of, like, we can train up staff to have, say, enforcement powers or to, you know, to manage some of the stuff once it's in place. But as to the pilots, we are hoping to put three into place. It does depend on, and it might be different things that are needed in different places. It depends what schools want and what the location's like and what the actual physical layout's like. So keeping an open mind in that sense, which is why we want to get as much info back as possible from as many schools as then, so we can choose, you know, different types of things in different areas and see what works. That is the kind of pilot scheme, so otherwise it's coming from your own end.
And connectivity and integrated cycle lanes was the second question.
Just talking about the same past, obviously, you know, it's not been good. So we need it, really change it rapidly for the future.
To catch up with other cities that are ahead of us.
We do. And all I can answer to that is I believe for the first time in 20 years of banging on about this, that there really is the political will from the very top to change it. Money could always be the issue. It's my job to prove to them that for your bang for your book, to put the segregated cycle lanes at the where they're necessary and needed, will give you more hits on environmental targets, on the air pollution targets, on the obesity targets, and just keep banging that message. Every time there's a pot of money available, I will do a better fashion.
Could you go back to Bond Street and see if we can get Bond Street to be
both? Can I just add to that some of the election members are very keen to Bob Street, and I did refer at the beginning of the meeting to the fact that we can invite other officers and other cabinet members to this meeting. With regards to cycling,